Hi, we're in Doc Talk Live, so we're sitting outside, drinking some wine, and we're doing our Doc Talk Live, and so I'm going to ask you to speak loudly, even though I have a microphone on this, because there are cars going by, and we're sitting on my porch. I'm with Deanne Somerall and Brandie Carbonie. Deanne and Brandie are both nurse practitioners. And I thought we would just start with how was your day today? And I'll start with you, Brandie, because I know you work today, and I'm really trying to get you to talk about work today. What was your day like today?
I had a good day. It was busy. Mondays are always busy because we're closed on Fridays, but it was a very good day.
What type of patients did you see today?
Let's see. I had a couple Medicare physicals. I had several anxiety patients.
Speak louder.
Sorry. I had several anxiety, depression patients, hypertension, diabetes, reflux, abdominal pain.
So just a mixture of things.
And, yes.
And I know, Deanne, you didn't take the day off. I heard you worked in a child care
situation.
But Deanne is a previous director of family practice. Nurse practitioner programs at
right.
UAB.
Yes.
And you retired, is it recently or?
About 18 months ago.
And
we're ranked number 9 in the country, just to okay. throw that out.
How long did you do this for?
I was the director for 5 years.
5 years you were the director, okay. And so when you started, what were y'all ranked?
We weren't.
So now we're 9 in the country. That's awesome.
What can you say?
Tell us a little bit about whether or not nurse practitioners should have the authority or not as far as having full practice privileges.
So in Alabama, we actually have 2 or 3 counties that have absolutely no healthcare providers. So if nurse practitioners did not have to have a collaborating physician who they had to, especially young nurse practitioners, people who have practiced less than 2 years, if they did not have to meet with that person once a week for 8 hours or once a week for 4 hours, it would allow them to go into these rural areas, especially where there's lack of health care.
And so that would open up healthcare for folks that
yes.
ordinarily could not get healthcare.
Yes.
And so what's the downside?
The downside is that many physicians are not in favor of this because nurse practitioners don't do the same amount of residency time. They don't go through the same rigor in academics that physicians go through, but...
Yeah, I'm constantly using my organic chemistry.
Yes, yes.
Constantly using that.
But nurse practitioners...
And my calculus, by the way.
Yes.
I'm inundated.
To help you do those
right.
drug calculations.
I'm inundated by calculus.
Yes. But what we have found is nurses have a 4-year degree, and then they go to college for a master's for at least 2 more years, and... In Alabama, you do some onboarding, and you always have those relationships that you develop.
I guess I would say I notice in my practice that there are certain things that I do over and over and over and over again. There's this repetition that I do over and over again that really practice can lead to competency.
Right.
The advantage for me that I see in a patient seeing a physician is when it's a little more complicated than usual and being able to dissect that nuance of maybe I need to look at this image a little bit closer
right.
or, and a lot of that has come from experience as well, not from having had organic chemistry or calculus for
right.
that matter. So. I struggle a little bit with the pre-med requirements even. You know, what is it about those pre-med requirements that really lead to medical school?
Yeah.
I don't, you know, maybe I need to do a Doc Talk Live on that.
Yeah, because one of the things that nurses a skill that nurses have is being able to talk to patients and get patients to tell us things. Like when I was a staff nurse 20 years ago, the doctor went in, talked to the patient, the doc leaves, I said bye, I go in and I said to the patient, how are you? And she said, I'm really having this crushing chest pain. And I said, did you tell the doctor? And she said, I didn't want to bother him.
Right.
Okay, well, now we're going to bother him because we're going to call a code. And nurse practitioners are known for pulling out information that gives them a quick diagnosis and a treatment plan. But I also think it's really important to develop those collaborations, maybe not on paper, where you can pick up the phone and call a physician and say, I saw this patient today, what do you think's going on?
Right.
So, you know, nurse practitioner is like a growing, I would say, thing.
Yes.
Right.
And so, in Brandie, I know that you're seeing patients just like internists see patients.
Right.
You've already described your day. We're already sitting down drinking wine and decompressing from a hard work day.
Right.
Do you think that this talking to the patient, I mean, a lot of times there's this, at least doctors can be pressed for time, especially if there's, you know, multiple patients backed up and waiting, whereas, I don't know, nurses are pressed for time too, especially on the floor, because we've created so much documentation unnecessarily for them that they've become more into documenting. But my point is you're functioning as a doctor. Do you find you're communicating like a physician, or are you still communicating like a nurse?
I think both.
I think both.
Yeah.
In fact, my husband, who is a physician, said that one day. He said, you are thinking on the medical model, but you're acting on the nursing model.
Yeah.
But that's ideal.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be ideal?
I think patients are more comfortable, too, a lot of times with, I mean, especially when it comes to like anxiety and depression,
yes.
They're not going to unload, I mean, not maybe on a physician as much. Where
they have to speak up because
well,
of
they
us.
Feel like they're bothering the physician, where they'll kind of get comfortable with us and then kind of say more than they normally would say. Especially being a female, too.
Yes.
That does help, too.
Yeah.
We have a little bit, I think, a little bit more understanding from that sense. But now I am a little torn. This might ruffle some feathers. I do not feel that somebody with no experience should be out on their own.
Yes.
As a nurse practitioner.
So one of the things that in Alabama we've looked at as we're exploring whether or not we should submit legislation for full practice authority is a graduated process. So a new graduate would have to have a collaborating physician for 2 or 3 years.
Okay.
They would have to document so many encounters, so many different situations. But somebody like me who's practiced 20 years or 22 years, that would be a little bit different.
So what are you doing now? You were leading UAB to the top nurse practitioner school in the country.
Yes.
She trained me, by the way.
Yes, I precepted her.
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
It was
I met her. She
I
was in nurse practitioner school.
I actually use a nurse practitioner at rehab, and I bet you trained her as well. And she's excellent, by the way. But what are you doing these days?
Now, I work a couple days a week, or a couple days when I want to, for a indigent care clinic that treats patients with diabetes. They're referred from the University Hospital emergency room and they come to us. And we have it's a grant the hospital has given us. So we have 2 diabetic educators, we have behavioral health, we have
So
a
are
counselor.
These patients with diabetes predominantly adult onset?
Yes. Yes.
So
we do see some type 1.
So translate that, this is a lot of overweight people. Yes,
yes,
no?
Some overweight, but mainly what happens is, so an example of the type of patient we see, my son works in the ED, he said, Mom,
the emergency department.
Yes, the emergency department. So he saw a patient one night, he said, Mom, I had this guy come in, his blood sugar was 400. Well, the patients I see in my clinic are like 600 and 800.
Wow.
So I'm like, oh, son, he's doing great. And he went, no, Mom, according to the guidelines. Which, no, he is not between 8, the patient was not between 80 and 130, but when the patients come to us, because they're indigent, they don't have enough money to buy wonderful foods, they eat at McDonald's a lot, the medicines for diabetes is really expensive. Our average patient has a hemoglobin A1C of 14, and we want them to be 7.
So, okay, so what do you, because the medicines are so expensive, what are you doing for an A1C of 14?
So, we're putting them on injectable insulin.
Okay.
We get samples from the drug companies. We get them on patient assistance, and we have social worker that is her primary job.
And how are you addressing their diet? Speaking of diet, can I offer you any food?
No,
are you sure?
No, I'm just going to drink wine.
All right.
So we have a dietitian who talks with the patients about their diet. But again, that is probably the hardest part for the patients because they're indigent, they have limited resources, and they eat a lot of macaroni and cheese. And one girl told me she had a Big Mac and French fries before she came to the clinic appointment. And I said, sweetie, even somebody non-diabetic shouldn't eat that. But that's what we do. And then the other clinic is called the Bessemer Neighborhood Health Center. It is in Bessemer, and it's a federally qualified health clinic. So we see patients who are indigent or have Medicare and Medicaid, and it's a sliding scale clinic. And we see a lot of what Brandie sees. We see upper respiratory infections. I fell and twisted my ankle. My blood pressure medicines are too expensive, and that's an easy fix because you can put them on great meds from Walmart for $4.
But the diabetes meds are challenging.
Yeah. Unless you can get them on patient assistance,
right.
And that's a hassle.
That is a hassle. We don't have the time to do that with the amount of patients that we see
in
a day. So, I mean, that's hard.
Well, I'm gonna leave it there for now, but I'm not gonna stop it.
Okay.
Because as soon as, actually, I'm gonna tell you I'm gonna stop it. All right. I'm gonna hit finish, but I'm not. And then I'm gonna let you guys just eat or whatever, okay? But I'm gonna keep it running for a little bit longer, just because I worry that you guys will start having, you'll start commenting on the comments. So go ahead.
What are we supposed to comment on the comments?
I don't know.
What are the comments?
No.
Okay.
Comments are how come I didn't get wine when I did a doc talk. That was one of the comments.
Who said that?
That's a good comment.
I like that comment.
Yeah, don't
do
that.
So,
but I am torn by the, okay, back to the nurse practitioner thing. Okay, because UAB, you guys are pumping out too many.
So now there's too many nurse practitioners.
No, there's not enough jobs in Alabama, and they were pumping out so many.
What do you mean there's not enough
jobs in Alabama? I'm sorry.
That's
there
fine.
Is not. Y'all were pumping out 600 a semester, correct?
No.
Okay.
I just ruffled feathers. 350.
Okay, 350.
Not a semester, once a year.
Okay, so 350 once a year. Go on.
And those were peds, neonatal, women's, adult, acute, family.
But there are not 350 jobs on Indeed.
But UAB's program, like Sanford's, where you graduated, it is a distance program.
Oh, okay.
You're getting people from Mississippi and Georgia and Tennessee. And if we can get full practice authority, there will be those jobs there. Because you'll get nurse practitioners that will go to these counties that don't have any health care providers.
Okay, because I teach for Stanford as an adjunct professor. None of my students can find a job because everywhere they apply, they want
new
experience.
Then they have to learn how to market themselves.
Yeah, that is true.
Because they have experience. They have precepted for 400-something hours.
Right.
They have been a nurse on the floor.
But, okay, back to that. So a lot of the nurses are coming out going straight from the nursing school into the
program. Doesn't matter. They already have, they have 2 years of experience.
Oh, I had 16.
Well, you're damn old.
I know.
Stop using that excuse.
But bad on you.
You should have come sooner.
I know, right? But, okay, I had a nurse one time, I won't name names, wasn't a UAB student. She couldn't take a temperature. We were running behind. I was like, hey, get a temp on that patient. She was like, how do you work that? I'm like, are you serious? You ought to know how to do every bedpan, IV, all of that.
But I had a resident who didn't know how to take a blood pressure with a manual cuff.
Well, you expect that from physicians.
No, you don't.
But no physician knows. Could you start an IV?
Yes.
Okay.
I start them on myself.
Oh, well.
That's another podcast.
You know how hot it is out here, right?
It's from tennis.
Yeah.
So I'll play tennis till exhaustion, and I'll keep IVs in my car.
Well, just get
And
the
now
Amazon
these
bag.
IV clinics have popped up all over the place.
There's a nurse practitioner in Gardendale that has started.
Yes.
What did you say?
There's an Amazon called IV Hydrate, and you order the bag, and one of the little packets equals an IV. I keep them at home all the time.
One of the little packets.
You mix
you
it with water, and it's and equal to a bag
it?
Of IV. Yes.
You drink
really?
It?
Yes.
You drink no, it's that's nonsense.
Well, I just ordered.
That
it.
Is nonsense.
Well, I haven't tried it yet. I was
no,
waiting when I
no,
go to Target.
No, that
person.
Is
you
nonsense.
You ordered on Amazon Prime, so you got a discount?
Listen,
yes.
I'm going to go back to my math,
okay?
Okay. A little thing of that cannot equal a big thing of water.
That is true.
There's
well,
no way.
And it's going into your bloodstream when you get
well,
it as
an IV. Well, it was $48, and I ordered it for my vacation.
So one of your patients is watching.
Hey, I love her. Come see me.
So. No, don't.
Don't.
Don't. You should be a lot better.
Yes. You should have been cured by now.
Right. She has. So she hasn't seen me in forever. She's my favorite. So.
Okay.
That's funny.
More wine?
I'm
you open
good.
More
she
wine?
She would be fun to drink wine with.
More wine?
I don't need it.
Okay.
But, okay, so I like that. He could have a little IV clinic out here after
yeah.
work.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, that's the way to go. That's the way to rehydrate.
That and it good. Really is. We go skiing. When we go skiing in Colorado, I always get altitude sickness.
Oh,
so
okay.
Now,
that's a great topic.
This guy out in Gardendale is like, come to me. Let me give you a couple liters. Go out there.
Before you go out there.
Yeah.
I usually take Diamox.
Oh, no, why don't you just do Diamox?
Here's why.
Okay.
You can't drink Diet Cokes, and I'm addicted to Diet Cokes.
Oh, well, you should cut
those
anyway.
Because it tastes like metal. Oh, really? Really? It tastes like metal. And I'm...
The Diamox makes the Diet Coke taste
that
like
that. That could be how you wean off the Diet
Why
Coke.
Is that?
That's like Lunesta makes everything
That would be
metal.
Something a physician would need to tell you. Yes. chemistry.
You should know that.
You should know that. Yeah.
I should know that. That's right.
I don't know.
But I take Diamox before I go skiing because I do get the altitude sickness.
I did 2 times ago, and it didn't make it any better.
Oh, it's
yeah. really?
It's prevented it for me
yeah.
big time.
Plus, I don't really like being cold. And the last time we went, my husband would wake up every morning and go, look, it's minus 17. I'm like, are you stupid? Why are we paying to go outside?
A lot of money, too. Yes, yes. And to
I
be
just
sick.
Stay inside and
yes.
be sick.
Yes.
Because I didn't understand the first time we went skiing. I didn't understand that you're supposed to limit your alcohol and increase your water. So I increased my alcohol and limited my water and thought I was going to die.
Where did you go again?
You
remember
my son-in-law has a home. No, I don't remember. It's
okay.
outside of Denver.
You can
okay.
go to the Dominican Republic much cheaper. Right yes.
All right. Well, I guess
you
I'm going
to go to Disney.
I guess I will actually hit finish now.
Okay.
See, that the last part was more interesting than the
yes,
first part.
It was. I liked it.
Absolutely.
She could be in a sitcom. She's
The patient said that when she was precepting with me. They're like, y'all are weird. Yeah, we are.
Finished.
That was